Okay, so today we'll be starting our specific paper class for CM1 for typing. So first, I would like to ask all of you, is there anyone who has started or tried out doing sums on MS Word for the paper you'll be appearing? Even if it's just a few sums, has anyone at least tried doing the sums? Yes, Shritama. Okay, so the ones who have tried it out, is there any specific problem that you faced while trying to type it out? No problems, you could easily type out the questions which you tried. I think probably you all must have. Yes, Sahil. Yes, Sahil, you want to say something?
Can you hear me now?
Yes, tell
Ah,
me.
perfect. Sorry, I think it was on mute. So I was saying that I tried typing a few questions on a few answers on Word, and there are a few things that I have been struggling with. For one is the speed, because the moment I start typing using equation editor, things get really, really slow. And the other thing is the notations. So I'm still confused whether to use equation editor for notations or whether I should be using the notations provided by IFOA.
Okay, so what I would suggest is, see the speed thing, obviously you all have to practice a lot so that you can make your speed good enough for the exams. So that I'm sure will be taken care of if you practice regularly. We will also be taking a few speed tests, etc. So don't worry about that with practice. You have a lot of time right now for that. As for the equation editor mode and the notations, today also I will be discussing. And there is no set pattern that for the entire paper you have to use equation editor or for the entire paper you have to use keyboard notations. You can easily do it depending on the question and whatever suits you. So for many people, it might so happen that certain questions, for example, the CT1 portion, since it is not so heavy on notations, you can use the standard keyboard notations over them. But for the even for the CT5 portion, in fact, you will realize that in most of the cases, the keyboard notations are actually easier to use than the equation editor, because in the equation editor, again and again, you will be having to choose from the structures given in the ribbon, right? Not all of them are readily available using shortcuts. So it's better if you use the keyboard notations. In fact, that is what both the institutes have always suggested as well. However, for some questions where, for example, if there is a question which is a little heavier on algebra, so maybe for your own convenience, if you do not use the letters or if you keep typing so many things in the algebra, it might get confusing for you. So in those questions, either you write it on paper first and then you type it out. That is one option. But for that, you have to be extra fast. The second option for which you require a moderate speed is the equation editor. Because if you're using the equation editor, all your answers will be concise. So for those questions where a lot of understanding is required, it's better if you use the equation editor. So right now, today, we will be looking at the specimen paper which the IFO had given for CM1. And in the next class, what we will do is I have arranged for a CM1 paper from a student who actually gave it on MS Word so that all of you can get an idea that on the exam day, along with the exam pressure and everything, what exactly comes out of your typing, even after all the practice, so that you all do not get nervous that how will you do it in the exam. It does end up completely fine, so don't worry about that. In the next class, you will see the paper, and I will make you all notice the parts where the striking parts, which you will realize that it is so natural actually, but it might stress you right now. So for today, let's just concentrate on the specimen paper. I will be showing you how to use the equation editor as well as how to use the standard keyboard notations. So yes, any other question as of now, anyone? Just give me a second. Yes, just because I switched off my camera for 2 seconds, all your cameras are off. Please keep them on. The others also, please. Thank you so much. Okay, so starting with the specimen paper, there are just 4 questions over here, and naturally these 4 questions are such which do require special mathematical typing skills. In your paper, you will also encounter some questions where mostly it's just numbers. For example, in most of the CT1 portions, in fact, there is hardly any special mathematical typing involved. It is usually just normal formulae and digits. It is the CT5 portion which uses a lot of notations. So in the specimen paper also, naturally, they've given all CT5 portion questions. I will be discussing a few CT1 portion questions as well later, so don't worry about that. And there will also be some questions which are theory based, and naturally it won't be a direct question. They will be more about commenting or analyzing, etc. Maybe, you know, if you are dealing with the CT1 question, then you might have to comment on the advantages or disadvantages of a certain measure or a certain method. But that will just be for 2 to 3 marks maximum, since obviously you will be having access to your material at all times. So for those parts, those are the parts where you just have to concentrate on speed. And I will be dealing with how you can highlight the keywords. Definitely, please don't forget to highlight the keywords in any of the answers, because it's as important as it is when you're giving it offline. So how you can highlight, I would strongly suggest don't underline or don't make it italics. Only use bold, because italics is something that is also present in the equation editor portions. So it might not strike as much because your equation editor portion will also be in italics. Underline also I do not suggest, because suppose there is a proofing error. Suppose there's a green line or a red line and you are underlining that word. So for example, I type infinity, but my spelling is wrong. So there is no issue in the spelling being wrong. They will not penalize you for this. But if you underline this to highlight it. So as you can see, the red line and the underline are getting hidden by each other. So this is why I would suggest that don't underline either. The best is that you make it bold. Best is to make it bold, because that is the only way it will stand out the best. Apart from that, let's start with the first question. So as you can see, they are specifying themselves that you do not have to make.
Actually, we cannot see the screen.
Oh, so sorry. I'll just show that infinity portion once again. I think that is the only one which required. So as you can see, I've typed the wrong spelling of infinity. So there's obviously a red line. I suppose if I underline it, you all can see how the red line and the underline are cutting off each other. So it is always better that you get everything, all your keywords are in bold, because that way it is hard to miss, right? All of you remember header, footer, No ARN should be on your answer script. Only your paper name, which is CM1A or CM1B, and the diet in which you are appearing for it. So I think for all of you, it will be April 2022. So that's it. That's all there should be on your header and footer. All your answers, when you start an answer, your answer number should stand out. So make it bold, maybe increase the font size a little. All of this is something you have to do while typing the entire answers in the stipulated time. So don't make the Word file before you download the question paper. Make it a point that after you have pressed download on the paper, only after that you open your Word file. All right, because otherwise the time of creation will be before the exam time, and you do not want that, because IFO and II both take it very seriously. So avoid doing all this. It is just one line, answer one, control B to make it bold. For increasing size, the shortcut is control shift and the greater than sign. So you can type it two times, so the size will increase. Next, once you start typing the answer, don't forget that your font settings is still bold and an increased size. So make sure before you start typing your answer every time, you make it unbold and you also decrease the font size. The standard font size should be 11 or 12 for your answers. And the line spacing also should be either 2 or 2.5. 2 is good enough. So I would suggest for the entire paper, you keep it at 2. Don't change the font. Let it be as whatever the default is, whether it's Calibri, Times New Roman, Arial, all are good, but don't change it to anything specifically. Don't use any color on your answer scripts. No highlighting, no making it red or blue to highlight it. Only bold, italics, underline. That's all you are allowed to make any special comments or special highlights in your answer script. All right. So, starting. What I'm going to do is I'm going to split my screen into two so that I have the specimen question paper and the Word file together. You all can also do this so that you have your question paper and your Word file together on the screen, so that you do not have to change tabs again and again. How to do this? You have to press Alt, the Windows key. The Windows key and the right arrow. When you press the Windows key along with the right arrow, whatever tab you are on, whatever the screen is open, it gets shifted to the right half of your screen. And then you choose the other paper or the other tab which you want, and it will come on the remaining left hand side of the screen. All of you must try and let me know if any of you face any problem in doing this. Okay, so starting with the first question. The first question says you have to calculate this using the AF92 mortality. And they have also given a note that you should show your working, but intermediate steps can be shown using numerical values. No additional notation is required. So obviously you have to realize that the institutes, they do not want you to waste time, or they do not want you to lose out on time even after knowing your concepts well. So they are going to be considerate, very considerate. In fact, in all the examiners' reports also, they mention that there is no penalizing regarding any sort of a typing error. Whether maybe if you are, suppose like I said, if you are using equation editor for half the paper and for the other half you are using keyboard notations, it doesn't matter. They are not concerned with that. All they are concerned with is that you have done the work yourself and you have explained it properly. So every step that you do, you do not have to use the notations necessarily, but make sure that you are adequately explaining yourself. So for example, over here, like they have said in the answer, only the last two lines are required for full credit. So the last two lines are just the numbers. So what happens is, maybe if you were giving it offline, it might so happen that you would have skipped the second last step. In fact, you would have just written the L38 by L box bracket 27, etc. You would have written the formula, but you would have straight away done it on your calculator and given the final answer. Maybe when you were giving it offline, this could have been done. But since you are giving it online, it is always better that more important than the formula itself is how you have put in the values in the formula. So always make sure that even if you're not writing the entire formula expanded, make sure that at least you write the values that you are putting in. And again, over here they haven't showed it, but make sure that every time you do this, you do such questions, make sure at the end of the question you give the reference. You give the reference as to where you got the values from. Maybe the page number. Some most of the values will be from the tables book. So for the interest rates, I don't think it's that required. Only if you're using a very special measurement from the interest rates portion. Let's say if you're using an increasing assurance formula or the increasing assurance value for any of the interest rates, then maybe you can give a reference that after, suppose I write IA. Suppose I write IA, let's say, at 7% interest. Suppose I write it like this, is equal to any value. Whatever value, I will take it from the table book. So obviously, every time you're using these values, you are referring to the table book, right? So every time you do this, just mention page, let's say, 25 of tables. Write the page number. Even for the tables book, write the page number so that at least you know that you have explained exactly where you are getting what. Because it did so happen that it does so happen people they might not write which page they are referring to, and they might take a wrong value. And if your error matches with someone else's, then you might be caught for plagiarism or collusion. So it's always better every time you're making any reference, be it to the material or be it to the tables book, mention it properly. All right, so how do we type this? Definitely a little bit of notation has to be used. Don't completely ignore it. Even if they are saying that it is not required, you should write it. Keep it in practice that you are writing at least one step of notations with the formula. So over here, for the deferred sign, the straight line, you can press shift and the key above the enter with the backward slash. That contains the straight line. So 10 deferred Q, 4. Now, as we know that when we write it, these numbers are in the subscript and not on the same line as the P or the Q. But for the purpose of giving the exams, they do not require you to put anything in the subscript or the superscript. So every single time we use values from table book, we have to mention page number. I would suggest yes, try to do that. But I know in CM1 it gets a little tedious because practically every sum will require you to refer to the tables. So for the very common ones, you can even let go of maybe one, two over here and there. But if possible, it is always better to stay safe. Just a matter of 2 seconds to type three words. As it is, you are already opening, you do not have to take extra effort to look at the page number. You can just write it there and then. All right, so it's better if you do it. All right. So they do not require you to write it in the subscript. You can just write it in this form. However, make sure you're using brackets very, very, very generously. Brackets is something you should use very generously in your Word file exams because it helps you become clearer. So for example, if I would have skipped the bracket over here, I would have just written this. So it might so happen, this can also mean that I was writing this, correct? It could also be this, but I do not want the examiner to feel that. So every time you are using multiple terms or expressions, make sure you put it into brackets so that they know it is one, it is acting as one. All right. Same for the P. So now what you can do over here is, maybe you cannot type it again and again. Instead of doing that, you can copy paste. You can copy paste and make changes wherever required. So for example, over here, I can simply copy paste and just make these changes. For the into, they have used the X, but please do not use X. It is just something that is going to make you also confused and something that is going to confuse the examiners as well. So it is better you use the asterisk. For the equation actor, I did teach you the shortcut of times for the cross, multiplication cross, but it is not required. Even if you are typing in the equation editor, just use an asterisk. Okay, it is easier, faster, and since it is something that you go on typing again and again, it's always better that instead of such a long thing, you just press one key. Okay. So this one is easy. 4Q38. In the next line, the two lines where the L's are involved. Here you can choose to write any one of the lines. You do not have to show both of them. You can choose to write any one. Make sure you're using a capital L and not a small L. This was done in the this is present in that table also, which IFOA has provided us with, where for the live tables you use a capital L and not a small L, because as all of you know, the small L might be a little confusing with other symbols or letters. It's always better you use a capital L. So let's say we skip the first step and we just L38 minus L42 divided by L27. So as you can see over here, for the 38 and the 42, we did not use any brackets. Why? Because 38 is anyway just one. But here, since we are using select mortality and since we are using the box brackets along with the plus one, it is always better that you use another bracket to show that it is actually one. All right. Then again, you will use the tables to look at the values of L38, L42, L box 27, etc. So probably you will get it in one page, or maybe you will get it on multiple pages. So if you are using multiple pages, you can either individually write down the page numbers, or it is all the tables are usually, they just stretch to over 2-3 pages or maybe maximum of 5 pages. So you can give the range as well. You can give a range also from pages this to this, or the individual page numbers for every single value. You do not have to write the entire line, but you can write something like from page 26, 28, and 30 of tables. You can write it like this also. All right. And then it's just plain numbers. Numbers you all can type easily. If any of you have access to a laptop which has the keyboard, the number pad on the right hand side as an additional thing, they are usually available in the bigger laptops. I would suggest you can use those laptops, especially for the CM1 examination, since it's so heavy on numbers as well. Your typing speed does tend to increase if you get into the habit, if you use the number pad instead of the numbers on top. However, there is not that much of a difference. Of course, it's better, but the others don't think that it is a disadvantage to you. It is not. It completely depends on how you practice from day one. Trust me, there is no set rule of typing. It is all dependent on your practice and your preferences. For someone might be faster in the equation editor, which is personally for me also. I prefer using the equation editor for most sums, because over there I get concise answers. However, in some portions of my papers, there were times where I knew that the only notation required was superscripts and subscripts. So just for the superscripts and subscripts, I do not want to get into the hassle of again and again entering into the equation editor. So I simply use standard keyboard notations. For superscript, it's the caret or the upward arrow. And for the subscript, it's the underscore. Now, one very important thing in the CMN paper regarding this is, let me just see if there is anything over here. So usually what we do is, suppose if you're writing the interest rate of 4% or 6% in the mortality tables, if usually we write it on top. For example, this is the A. In the bottom, we, as the subscript, we write the period and the age. And as the superscript or on top of the A, we usually write the interest rate, right? The 4% or the 6%. So over here, you have to realize in CM1, one very big difference is that 4% or 6% is actually not something that is to the power, or it is not something that is in the superscript. It is just something that we write it because there is no other space left. So for those questions, suppose it is A40, or let's say it's ADU40, and on top you had to write 4%. Instead, what you do is you have to write calculated at 4% interest. I think over here, no, in the specimen paper they haven't shown it, but in one of the answer scripts, the solved answer scripts, etc., this is the standard way of writing it, because there is a difference between to the power of and between the interest rates that you are writing. Okay. So for now, moving to the second question. Is the first question clear to all of you? Do any of you have any questions in the first part, first question? No questions, everything's clear. Okay, so now one very important thing. As you all know, every answer should start on a new page. However, do not press enter till you reach the next page. No, you have to make sure, I will show you why. Okay, so for example, my answer is incomplete over here. I still have to add two steps. But let's say I did not know what the two steps will be. So I wanted to move on to the next answer. I pressed enter till I moved to the, got to the next page. I type answer 2. And then I start typing the next answer. Let's say 2.75 cubed 84.5, etc. I started typing. Now, after the end of my exam, now I finally have time to go back to the first question. So what I do is I start typing the next line. Let's say 9872. Then I typed another line, 0.003606. Okay. So now what will happen? Once I did this, as you can see, my answer 2 has started moving down. So as and when I will keep on adding lines to my answer script in the middle, everything below it will start moving down. Why? Because the word application, it considers that the number of enters you had pressed earlier is the space that you require between the two portions. They do not realize that the purpose for doing that was going to the next page for your next answer, right? So how to solve this problem? Nothing much. It is a very, very simple thing. And make sure all of you do this. So I ended my answer over here. This entire portion has to be left blank. I will go to insert and I will insert a blank page over here. So what happens is this entire portion is left as it is. And now I type my start typing my second answer. So now what happens if suppose, even if the portion that's left, which I'm going to add on at the end of my exam, even if it exceeds the remaining portion in this page, it is going to move on to the next page and my answer 2 will move to the third page instead. it is not like my answer because of the space constraint, it will stop over there. So don't worry about that. My answer row will move on to the third page automatically. And whatever space is left after my answer will remain blank. So in that way, every answer, no matter what, will start on a new page. Because trust me, at the end of the exam, you will not have the time to sit and format your paper again. Whatever you will do has to be done while you're giving the exam. Is this clear?
Ma'am, can you just repeat again how to just leave the space and then move on to the next page?
Okay, nothing. As soon as you're done with your answer, whatever answer you're attempting, you're done. Suppose I ended over here. I do not know what to write after this. I go to the insert tab on top, just after the home tab. And here in the pages option, the very first group, you will get the option of a blank page. So I'm inserting a blank page over here. So that automatically takes me to a new page. And now I can start typing in this new page. Instead of pressing enter, 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 and going to the next page. All right, is it clear now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, great.
Ma'am?
So
then we'll start typing in the blank page which we have inserted now.
Yes. You do not touch this remaining portion until and unless you have to add something to the previous answer.
Okay, thank you.
Just give me a second. Just pausing for a minute. Yes, sorry. So, moving on to the next question. The next question asks us again, it is a very basic CT5 question. We have to use uniform distribution of deaths to calculate the value of 2.75Q84.5. Again, as I had said, no requirement of using subscript, superscript. For example, if you do want to use the subscript, superscript method, what you can do is you can enter into the equation editor mode. So as you can see in these examples, these are the kind of questions where it is always better that you use the standard keyboard notations, right? Because there is no hassle at all. There is not much of a difference in what you would have written on paper or what you are typing. It is just that the alignment is different. Instead of going subscript and then normal alignment and again subscript, you're writing everything in one line. So that way, I think for these questions, it is any day easier to use the standard keyboard notations. Now, suppose if we wanted to type this, let's say I will enter it to the equation at the mode. We'll have to go to the large operators and we'll choose this one, the last one, the left subscript superscript one. All right, so here what we will do is on top we do not require anything on the left side. On the left side in the bottom we want 2.75, then we want a Q, and now for the normal subscript, for the right hand side subscript, we need 84.5, and then we move out of it. So as you can see, any day, it is easier to use the standard keyboard notation over here than going and selecting a structure and typing it out, correct? So I would strongly suggest stick to this for this one. Okay. So first of all, you have to show these steps. As you can see in this question, you have to show the steps. Let's say you might want to skip this one if you want. You can skip the step of showing that Q is equal to 1 minus V. That step you might skip for all of them. Again, one very important thing, if there is any sort of calculation that is repetitive. So let's say if you are doing this calculation for these numbers, 1 minus 2.75, now for another two, three similar things, you have to write the same thing, correct? Even though the steps are the same. So what you can do is you need not show the steps for all of them. You can just show it for one or two and the rest you can straight away write the answer. That is something that is still acceptable because end of the day, they know that whatever you're doing, you have explained yourself in one of the parts. So for the other parts, it is not necessary that you have to explain. You can straight away do the calculations on your calculator and write it. But this is not that kind of sum. In fact, I don't think in CM1 we do encounter any such sums mostly. In the other papers, it is there, so I have discussed it with them. But here, in case any such question comes where the calculation is very repetitive, which means you are doing the same calculation again and again, let's say maybe for a table. If you are making a table and you are filling in the rows or the cells, in that case, you can just show the calculation for any two cells and the rest of the cells, you can directly write the value. So is equal to, you can skip the first step and the next step, 1 minus 0.5 p, again don't use x or the times one, simply use an asterisk, 0.25 p 87. As you can see over here also, they have used brackets a lot. If you were writing this on pen and paper, you would not use these brackets, you would straight away just write the notations. However, to ensure that this entire thing is one and not just the 0.25 is being multiplied, that is why you should always use brackets properly. All right. Similarly for 0.5, then you still just show the calculation for the individual portions. Oh, I missed one part. This one. Into 2.55. So again, capital L, capital D for life table functions always. And the rest of it is just the same, it is just numbers. So I don't think any typing has to be explained in this question. Moving on to the next question, the delta sign for the force of interest. Of course, you can always, either you can enter the equation editor mode and just get delta like this, or you can go to the insert tab, and you can symbols group. Inside the symbols group, initially you will have to go to more symbols and search for the symbols which you require, but as and when you type them out or start using them frequently, they will come up in your recently used. Greek symbols, I need delta. Here is the delta. So you can insert delta from here, or you can enter into the equation editor mode and simply use backward slash delta. In fact, this is something you can do for all Greek letters. You can enter into equation editor mode and let's say mu lambda sigma. Are there any other Greek letters which you will use in CM1? I don't think there are any other Greek letters involved. Usually these four are the only ones. But anyway, for any letter, whatever the name of the letter is, you can just type it with a backward slash. And in case there is any letter for which you do not know the spelling, or you're unsure of the spelling or the name, how will you find it out? You will go to the equation editor mode. As soon as you enter, this new tab opens, right? For all of you, the new tab opens. So if you do not know the spelling or the shortcut, here you can see that all the symbols are available. Let's say if I go to Greek letters, maybe suppose someone is not sure whether theta is THITA or THETA. So what they can do is, when they go and take their cursor on the theta symbol. As all of you can see at the bottom, the name of the letter as well as the shortcut that is required to get that letter in the equation editor mode, both come up. So in that way, before the exam, make sure that all the variables that you might have to use in your exam, you know the names to all of them and the shortcuts to all of them. In case you don't, before the exam, please make sure that you note it down or you remember it or memorize it. Because don't keep these things for the exam day. It is not possible that on the exam day you will go and you will search for so many things. Don't keep all that hassle for that thing. Before that, make sure all this is pre-exam preparation, which you must do always. Okay, so question 3 gives us the force of interest as a function of time measured in years, and they've given us the formula. So we need an expression for AT, the accumulated amount of at time T of a unit investment made at time T for equal to 0, for 0 less than T less than equal to 6. The less than equal to, if I would suggest, if there is a question which does not involve any special mathematical typing, so you do not need to enter the equation editor mode. Just for the less than equal to or greater than equal to sign, just to get that sign, don't go into the mode and come out. It is absolutely unnecessary. You can simply use this. There is absolutely no harm in using this in your answer script. It is just something that is going to save your time and make everything faster. So don't, just for the greed of getting that symbol in your answer script, don't unnecessarily enter into the equation editor mode. All right, even these signs are equally acceptable and they won't make much of a difference in your answer either. So then for the next answer, we'll go to insert pages, blank page, and we'll start with answer 3. Now, answer 3, the first part is we have to find an expression for AT. So as all of us know, this will be done using integration. Integration again is a very important concept for mathematical typing. Two ways, of course, equation editor or the keyboard notation. First, we'll do the keyboard notation. It is e to the power infinity from 0 to t, and then you integrate this. This is the function which has to be integrated, the delta t that is given, right? That is what we want to type. So for e to the power something, we write exp, and inside the bracket we write whatever was supposed to be in the power of the exponential. All right, you do not have to give the caret sign in this case. Every time you write exp, it is given that the whatever is inside the bracket is supposed to be in the power. The caret sign over here is not required. So exp, what do we have to write? We want to integrate from 0 to t. So I integrate is always capital INT. There were multiple ways of writing integration, but this is the way that I would suggest all of you to follow. You write INT, inside the first brackets, you write the limits. We write the limits inside the first bracket. So what is done? The integration sign is done by the INT. The limits of 0 to t is done by writing inside the bracket. Now we put a colon and we write whatever function we are integrating. So here, what are we integrating? Make sure you use a bracket over here again, so that the entire function, where the function starts and where the function ends, is very clear. Because suppose if you do not use a bracket again, it might so happen that it will come off as only the 0.24 is being integrated. But that is not what we want, correct? So we will use brackets again and then write the dp. Again, we will close the brackets for the exponential. Clear? Now, when you solve this, it might so happen, this one is an easy integration. It can happen that there is a complicated integration for which you have to show steps inside the integral, right? Matlab ki for let's say 2-3 steps, you will have to show integration. In such cases, it is better that you copy paste it. If it is a very similar formula, a similar expression, it's better that you keep on copy pasting and just editing the values as and where required. Okay, instead of typing it again and again. Now, how do we do this in the equation editor mode? So, first of all, we require V to the power. In fact, I would suggest even in the equation editor mode, don't get into the hassle of going E to the power, because then whatever you're writing in the superscript, no, it becomes very small. The font size becomes small. So it is not as clear. It is, that is why it's always better. In fact, even when we used to give it offline, that is what we always kept in practice, that whenever there is a huge power, a huge expression in the power of the exponential, it is better that you write exp and write it inside the brackets of the same line, instead of writing the entire thing in the superscript. So here also, this is what I will suggest all of you practice. So for the integration symbol, the shortcut is INT. You get the integration symbol. Now, a very important thing, an error that might happen in case you do not notice this, how to get the limits. The limits, of course, lower limit, you will use the underscore. And for the upper limit, you will use the caret sign. But it might so happen that after giving the lower limit, let's say suppose, I will show it to you. Let's say suppose I gave a space. So my lower limit came, but now I do not have any way to add my upper limit. If I write this, nothing will happen, because now the cursor has moved out of the integration sign. All right, so make sure that whenever you are using integration in the equation editor mode, you type out both the upper limits and the lower limit together at the same time without pressing any spacebar. Okay, it always has to be done. The entire thing has to come, and only then you press the spacebar to get the limits in their position. All right, so now we will type our equation. This is how you do it in the equation editor mode. Next, part two is derive the values of a and b, where at is equal to e to the power a plus bt. So over here, what do? We have to solve something. So here is where you use your discretion as to how many steps you want to show in your solving. Try to show as many as your speed permits you. Definitely for one mark, you should ideally show two steps. For every one mark, you should show one and a half to two steps approx. And of course, if you have the adequate speed, then try to show as much as possible, because it just gives you an upper edge. There is nothing like you will be penalized for showing extra. But it is always better as much as you disclose on your answer script itself. So for part two, for t less than 6, again, the same thing which we got in the first part, the solution of the integral. Now this integral again. So for example, over here, what they have done is they have skipped a step, right? What have they skipped? They have not shown, let's say, if you were doing it on paper, you would have to show a separate step showing the change of variables, because t is already in the limits, so you cannot use t inside the integral. So one step you would have to show of changing the variables. Then the next step you would have to show where you would solve the integral in the box bracket form, correct? So that would be 0.24s minus 0.02s squared. And you would have to write the limits on the box bracket, correct? So now how do we write the limits on the for the box bracket? Same way as we used for the integral. Together we will type both the limits, so it will come as you want it, in just after the box bracket, on top and on the bottom. Okay, so this is done. So this step also you would have to show. And then finally, in the last step, you would show the substitution of t and 0 in this equation. So as you can see, since it was only for 2 marks, these are the steps which you can skip It is just 2 marks. So anyway, 1 mark is definitely for writing this integration. So you can, let's say you can show one step of either this, or you can show a step where you have substituted the t and the zero separately, and then finally the answer. Ideally, these are the steps that would be required in this question. Since it's online, all of these steps aren't required. You can just give 2 to 3 steps. Clear? The default alignment of the equation editor is center. Is there any way to change left? By default, there is no way. However, what you can do is, every time you type it, there is a shortcut, Control L, which is the left alignment shortcut. So every time you are working in the equation editor, make it a habit that as soon as you are done, you just, before pressing, going out of the mode, you just press a Control L and then you go up. If you get into this habit, then automatically everything will be left aligned. Honestly, there is no harm even if it's centrally aligned on your paper, because there are no marks as such for that. Just for format considerations, if you want to do it, it's fine. All right. Yes, Shreya?
Ma'am, actually, I just forgot. Can you just repeat how to split screen and how to bring the equation editor?
Sure. So how to split the screen? I will just unsplit it once. So suppose I'm on my Adobe Reader right now. I want my Adobe Reader to be on my left half of the screen. So I will press the Windows key, the 4 boxes on your keyboard, along with the left arrow together. Windows key with the left arrow. And then automatically for my right hand side, I start getting options. That which one do I want on my right hand side? So I will press this Word document, which I want on my right hand side. As for the equation editor, the shortcut is Alt along with equal to, together Alt and equal to. All right. That is how you enter the equation editor.
How to unsplit?
How to unsplit? There is nothing that you have to do to unsplit. Once you split it, you can do anything. If you want to, let's say, increase the size of this one, you can do it just like you do it normally. There is no harm in that. If you want to change it from half and half to, let's say, 1/3, 2/3, you can easily do that as well. This is just a shortcut for making it half and half. There is no fixed thing that happens. All right?
Okay, ma'am.
So for part 3, calculate present value of $100 due at time t equal to 7. One very, very, very important thing is that don't forget to write the units in your answer. If the question, for example, in part 3, the answer will come in dollars, correct? Because it's an amount. So don't forget to give the dollar sign. It's just written 4. So make sure you use units properly in your answer. Even where the answers come in interest rates, use the percentage sign. If suppose the question is in pounds, you can I don't think it will work on these keyboards, but those of you who have the side number pad on your keyboards, you all can turn on the numlock. You all can press Alt along with 0613. Alt 0613 is the shortcut for getting the pound sign. Rest of you can either just write 56 pounds or 56 pence, or what you can do, if you really want to use the symbol, you can again go to the symbols tab and insert the pound symbol for your answer. All right. For Mac users, there is a shortcut. I think it is Option+3. It is either Option+3 or Control+3. I will just confirm that in the next class. But that is only for the Mac users. For the Windows keyboards, that doesn't work. For the Windows keyboard, either it's Alt 0613, or you have to use the insert symbol. Clear? So is everything clear up to here? Is there any question regarding whatever we discussed today? Okay, so what I want all of you to do is, all of you can get this paper on the IFOA website, where the section where you have all the past papers and the examiner's report. Over there itself, if you scroll a little, you will find the specimen question paper for CM1 September 2020. You can download that paper, and I want all of you to just practice the typing. It might so happen that all the concepts you might not know till now if you've not covered those chapters, but whatever you do know, at least look at whatever they have typed, and if you know the concept, then good enough. At least you know what you would have written on paper and how you're typing it. So the first three questions, I want you all to practice at home once, and if possible, of course, maybe if I take the class tomorrow or day after, then it will not be possible. But as a side thing, every single day, I want you, especially since most of you, I think it will be your first paper. So for, I'm unable to insert the pound sign using all shortcuts, and different sign is coming. Okay, Unnati, what you can do is, I'm just writing my contact number in the chat box. So you can, in case any of you have any specific issues while practicing, you all can either contact me on this number, or you all can discuss it in the next class, because for CM and especially, we will be having a few more classes compared to the others, since for most of you, it's the first time you will be giving an exam on board. So I want you all to practice a minimum of three questions. A minimum of three questions every single day on MS Word. No matter if you're doing, even if you're doing 50 questions at home for practice, definitely three questions you have to do on MS Word. And make sure that it's a mixed bag, whatever you're practicing. Every day, don't do the same topic. Every day, try and choose a question where there is a significant amount of notations involved, or where you feel that a lot of typing is involved, so you will have to increase your speed in that. You take up such questions. Don't take up very long questions, because that's not that important. It is more important that you concentrate on accurately typing fast. Not very fast as of now, but definitely your speed should be adequate enough for you to finish the paper on time. So definitely from today itself, please start practicing at least three questions a day on MS Word for now. And after that, in the next class, again, we will continue with this. I will show you a sample paper, and we will discuss some more tips and some more specific things in the paper that you have to take care of. So I think that's it for today. Thank you, all of you.